The next speaker is BogDan Vatra from KDAB, and he's going to talk about extending Qt on Android apps using JNIi.
I'm BogDan Vatra. I'm the guy who ported Qt on Android. And today, we're going to see how to extend your Qt application by accessing APIs that are not available yet in Qt. Yesterday, if you joined my session, we saw how to set up everything, how to use Qt Creator, and how to deploy and sign your package. But today, if you want to access more things that are not available in Qt, you'll need to do, we're going to see how to do that. The session has two parts. First part, it's an introduction to JNIi, and the second part, it's a real-life example that we are going to use the knowledge that we learned in the first part. First, I think this thing doesn't have a battery anymore. Okay, so what's JNIi and why do you need it? JNIi stands for Java Native Interface. It's needed to do calls from Java to C++ and the other way around, from C++ to Java. Why do we need it? Well, because it's impossible for Qt to implement all Android features. So in order to use some of them, we need JNIi to access. This is a list with just a few APIs that you'll not find in Qt. For instance, you can't listen for operating system notifications like SD card notifications when the card is removed or entered. When the network notifications, like when the network goes up, goes down, when the cellular network is available or not, battery level, or some Android features that are not available through Qt API, like telephony to initiate calls, to send the text message or the multimedia message. Again, there is no way, for instance, to access contacts from Qt. You'll need JNIi, speech, system account, system preference. NFC will be available in Qt 5.6, but if you want it now, you need to use JNIi, USB printing, and many, many other things. So, the introduction. There are two use cases here. First is how to call a function, a Java function, from C++, and the other use case is to call back a C++ function from Java. First, we need to create a function. We create a class. We have this Fibonacci function that computes the Fibonacci number. Then it returns the Fibonacci result. Let's see how we call it from C++. It's easy. We are going to use the Android Extras module, which makes our lives much, much easier. And to call it, we just need I really need a pointer. 1 second to switch the... Okay, so first you need to add the Android extras in your profile in order your project to include this Qt module. Then from C++ you need to include Android JNIi object. This class allows you to call static methods or Java methods very easily. The template parameter is actually the return parameter. Then first parameter of this function is the class name, Java class name, which in our case, by the way, this is fully qualified Java class name, It contains the package and also the class. Here is the package, here is the class. The second parameter is the method name, which is Fibonacci. And the third parameter is the function signature. Here is the integer parameter that we need to pass to the Java function. And again, it returns an integer. The next parameters are the parameters that this function will pass to the Java world. And that's it. That you only need to do to call a Java function from C++. Next case is to call back a C++ function from Java. When something happens in Java, we need to notify the C++ world. And we are going to see how to do that. First, there are three steps you need to do. First, you need to declare a method in Java using the native keyword. Why we need that? Because Java needs a way to tell the virtual machine that this function it's not defined in Java, but sometime later, the C++ world will register a function and they will match. And when the Java code will call this function, actually will go to the native world. Then we need to register the function in C++, and from Java, we need to call it. Let's see the Java code. So we have the same code. We just extend it a little bit. We declare the native method using the native keyword. Then we create another function that computes the Fibonacci number, but instead to return the result, it calls back the C++ word and sends the result. So first function computes the Fibonacci number and returns the result in one call. So the Java world doesn't need to call back the C++, it just returns the result. In the second function, in the second example, we call this function from C++. This function computes the Fibonacci number, but instead to return the result, use this native method to send back in C++ word the result. There are two ways to register native methods in C++. First way is to use Java fully qualified class name, method name template. And for our Fibonacci function, we need to name it like this, Java com KDAB training, because the Fibonacci function is in com KDAB training package, my Java natives underscore Fibonacci result. The first two parameters are the same for all native functions. First parameter is the environment that calls your function. The second parameter is the class, the object of the class that calls you. And after these two parameters are the parameters that are sent from Java. In our case, it's an integer number that we just printed on the output. Using this way to register functions, it has advantages and disadvantages. The advantages are it's easier to declare. You don't need to do to specify the function signature or to specify the function for the virtual machine. You just need to use that template and it will register for you. And as I said, you don't need to explicitly register it. The downside is that the functions name are quite big. You can see here. The library needs to export all these functions. We'll see later that there is another way to export these functions using a single function to export them. And it's unsafer because there is no way for virtual machine to check the function signature. Why? We go back because the functions are exported as C functions, not C++ functions. So the linker will only export the name, not also the parameters. There is no way for the virtual machine to know your parameters. Meaning that if you change the function signature in Java and you forget to change it in C++, your application will crash or will misbehave because there are different parameters. There is another way to register the functions using JNIi environment register native. There are four steps to do that. The last one is to use register natives. with a class that contains all the methods that we want to register, the class ID in Java that contains all these methods, a methods vector, and the methods number. To find this class ID, we need to use JNIi environment find class. This we need to pass the class signature, the fully qualified class signature, and it will return an ID for us. Then we also need to create a vector in C++ with all the C++ methods that we want to register to make visible in the Java. And to get our hands on the JNIi environment, we only need to export a single function per shared object file. And we can define this function on any C++ file you like. This function has this parameter that is coming from Java. This function will be loaded automatically by Java, so you don't need to call this function manually. It's called automatically by Java. And it passes this virtual machine pointer that we are going to use to get the JNIi environment pointer. Let's see the code. So we have the C++ Fibonacci function. As you can see, it doesn't have that long name. Actually, here you can put any name you like. You can name it F1 or F2, whatever. We create the vector with one JNIi native method structure. The JNIi method structure has the following fields. First field is the function name. It needs to match with the function that you declared in Java, not in C++. So this is the function that you've declared in Java. The function signature that you declared in Java, and the function pointer of the C++ method. Again, in this example, they are the same, but this one can be named as you like. It doesn't have to be the same with this one. It's nice to have them the same because it's easier for you to find them, but it's not a requirement. Then, as I said, we need to export a single function, which is JNIi on load. Again, we need to export it as a C function, not a C++ function. And this function is called automatically by Java after it loads the shared object file. And it passes the Java virtual machine pointer. We use the virtual machine pointer to get the environment. Then, with this environment, we find the class. Again, it must be fully qualified class name, including the package name and then the class name. And we use this class to register our methods. If everything is OK, the execution continues. If the signature that you declared in C++ doesn't match with the signature that is defined in Java, a virtual machine will throw an exception and it will stop the execution, meaning that it will be easier, much easier for you to catch any errors. So you don't have to wait until your application crash. It will stop the execution at startup. So using this method, the advantages of using this method is that the native functions can have any name you want. You don't need to use that huge template. The library needs to export a single function, which is JNIi on load. You don't need to export all the native functions because, as you've seen, they are static functions, so they are not visible at all. And it's safer because, again, the virtual machine can check the declared signature. The downside is that it's a little bit harder to use, but for 23 lines of code, I think it's worth to go with this way to register the function. Next. So we've seen the introduction. Any questions so far? OK, let's see the SD card notification. So the game plan. First, we need to understand the Android files that are part of your project. Then we need to see how to use an external IDE to manage the Java part. we are going to use the external IDE to import the existing Android files and to debug also the Java part. Then we are going to discuss about the architecture of Qt on Android application, how to extend the Java part of your application, how to do safe calls from Qt thread to Android thread. We'll, in a few minutes, we will see that there are two threads involved, and we must be careful when we do calls from one thread to another, and how to do safe calls the other way around from Android thread to Qt thread. First thing first, let's see the Android files that are part of your project. Every time when you want to extend your application, you first need to create the Android templates. To do that, you need to go to Projects Perspective, Open Projects Perspective, click on Build tab, expand Build on Android APK, and here you have create templates. Make sure you copy the Gradle files in order to be able to import the Java project from your Qt project to Android Studio. Meaning of the Android template files, the Android manifest file is your Android manifest file. Res values libs, this XML file contains information about the needed libs that we need to pack together with your APK or the libs that Ministro needs to download from the server. Build Gradle, this is the project file that is needed by Android Studio. If you don't click this button, that those files will not be copied, so make sure you, this checkbox is always checked. Gradle wrapper, this is a build script wrapper that builds this one. This script will trigger the download of the Gradle files, everything, and will be used by Qt Creator to build your final APK, to create your final APK. Gradle wrapper, these are the build scripts file, wrapper files. Using Android Studio for Java part. Why we need to use Android Studio to manage the Java part, to edit, to do all the stuff? Well, because Qt Creator, the Java support in Qt Creator is close to zero. You only can create a file, you have some syntax highlighting, and that's it. But if you want to be able to debug, or to have some code completion, or all these 21st century features that you expect to find in IDE, you will not find them in Qt Creator. So you need to use one of these IDEs that are provided by Android. It's Android Studio and Eclipse, which is deprecated, and you should move to Android Studio instead. In this talk, I'm going to show you how to use Android Studio to manage, to handle the Java part of your application. So, first you need to do is to open the Gradle project. Actually, Android Studio will be used only to open the Gradle project, create and edit Java files, debug the Java part. The external IDE will not be used to run the application. You still need Qt Creator to run your application. How to open the Android files in Android Studio? It's easy. You just need to point the build.gradle project that Qt Creator created for you when you press the Create Templates button. And then Android Studio will load everything, will see all the dependencies and all the stuff. How to debug with Android Studio? It's easy. You need to set the breakpoints, attach the debugger after you run the project using Android Studio, wait for the application to start, select the application and click OK button. Then, when your Java part will hit the breakpoint, it will stop the execution there and you can debug your Java part using Android Studio. Okay, the problem comes when you need to start debugging very early. No matter how fast you think you are, in order to attach, to see the application running and attach to it and then wait to the debugger to attach to the running application, it takes time and you might miss the breakpoint that you set. In order to be sure your application will wait for Android debugger, you need to add this line in your extended Qt instance, Java instance, Java activity, and this line will wait until the debugger is attached to your application. Then it continues the execution, and you have control to your debug steps. Okay, before we move forward, I need to tell you a few things about the architecture of any Qt on Android application. Any Qt on Android application, it has at least two threads. It's the Android thread, the blue square from the your left, and after the Android thread starts and it loads all your Qt files, all your Qt shared objects and all the dependencies, then it creates another thread where it starts the Qt. Why do we need that? Well, because when the Android thread calls your main function, the main function waits until your Qt application exits, quits, right? The problem is, doing that, we are blocking the Android thread. Blocking the Android thread, it's also blocking the Android event loop, and we don't get any events from Android anymore. And all the events, all the touch events, all the other events that we need in order to make your Qt application to run are coming from Android thread. So we really, really need to create another thread for Qt to run. So the problem is, when you call something from C++ to Java, and that thing must be created. For instance, you want to create a control, right? That those controls, those Android controls, Android native controls, Android Java controls, must all of them be created on Android thread. But we are here, we are in C++ thread. So from now on, I'm going to show you how to do a safe call. You see there are three steps involved. First is to go from C++ world to Java world, but we are still in the Qt thread. Then we are going to post a runnable on Android event loop. The Android event loop will pick up the runnable, and it will run the runnable on Android thread, and it will do the right job in the right thread. Again, if something happens in Java and we need to send to Qt the signal, let's say the SD card was removed, right? And we want to display this information or make this information available to Qt. This information is coming on Android thread. We call back the C++ method in but we call it in Android thread. From here, if we try to display something on the screen or to change some object states without synchronization, it will crash. What we'll do the same thing that we did in Android thread. Instead to access this object directly, we're going to delegate the call in Qt thread, and we do all the job in Qt thread. So there are six steps involved here. First, we need to, so this presentation, I'm going to show you first the Java part and then the C++ part to be easier for you to understand. First, we need to extend the Java part in order to get our hands on an Android activity. The Android activity is very important for you, because without it, you can't create most of the Android controls. So first, you need to get your hands on Android activity. The easiest way to get your hands on an Android activity is to create your own Android activity by extending the Qt activity. First thing you need to know, don't change any existing Java files. Every single Qt project has some Java files that we keep hidden for you, because we don't want you to change them. But if you really want to change them, you can do that. But we do recommend you not to do that. otherwise your application will start to misbehave and you don't know why after that. There are two Java files. First one is the Qt activity and another one is the Qt application. There is no need to extend the Qt application, only the Qt activity is enough. How to extend it? It's easy. You create your own activity, you import the original Qt activity and extend it. Here we, for the SD card notification example, first we need to register a broadcast receiver. This is a listener that listens for SD card notifications. And we are going to call this register broadcast receiver from the main function of the Qt, meaning that this function is called from Qt thread. So we have some code in C++ that calls this function, this receive broadcast receiver, right? But instead this broadcast receiver to register the receiver runnable from in Qt thread, it posts a runnable using this run on UE thread. This is actually a runnable. It posts this runnable on Android thread. We'll see later how Android thread will pick up this in the next slide. We'll see how Android thread will pick up and do it to run this. Okay. After you create your activity, you need to change the default activity to Android manifest file from qt.org, qt5 Android bindings Qt activity to your new activity. This means when the application will start, it will load your activity first, then it will pass the execution to the the Qt activity. Let's see how register receiver runnable looks like. It implements the runnable interface. Here, you only need to override the run function, and here we create our listener, our intent filter, and we register the receiver here on Android thread, not on Qt thread. So, what you need to remember is this run on UI thread function that has any activity, any Android activity has it. This is how you post something on Android thread that can be run later on. Okay, the receiver is simple. We take the activity pointer that is passed here. We save it, and then when this function is called on Android thread, we set the filter and we register our SD card listener. The SD card listener is simple. We overwrite the onReceive function, and when the operating system sends the notification when the SD card is mounted or unmounted, we call back the C++ word here. Again, this happens on Android thread. There are two native functions that are used here. We need to declare them, and that's it. So the diagram of the Java part, we have some C++ code that calls register broadcast receiver on Java. On Java, instead to register the runnable, register the SD card listener on Qt thread, which is illegal, it posts a runnable on Android thread. The runnable is picked up by Android event loop. Then it runs the run function for you. And here, you can do anything you want on Android. You can create controls, you can register runnables, or whatever you want. Then something happens in Java. We get a notification, and we send back the notification to C++. This is how the Java part looks like. Any questions so far? No. OK. Let's see the C++ part. First, we need to call our Java function to register the broadcast receiver. As I told you, we call it from main function. This means it's called from Qt thread. Then we have a simple widget application. It has two slots. These slots are not called directly by Java. By the way, Java cannot call C++ object methods. It only can call simple functions, simple C++ functions, not methods. So from Java, every time when you call, you call a function, not a method. So we have these two slots. We are going to see soon why do you need them. And when we got the on mounted, its slot is called, then we print something on the screen. We append the text on the screen. Same when the media is unmounted. Now we have these two functions, these two static functions that I told you. These functions are called from SD card listener. And these functions, you remember the number 4 that I told you when something happened in the operating system and the operating system calls back the C functions? These are the C functions that are called directly from Android thread. And here, we do the same trick that we did on Java part. Instead to call the onReceiveMounted directly, we invoke this method, and this method, onReceiveMounted, will be called not here on Android thread, but in Qt thread. This is how we delegate the call from Android thread. Actually, this is how you delegate a call from any thread to Qt thread. So if your Qt application has multiple threads and you want to display something on the screen, this is the way to do it, using a Q meta object invoke method. First parameter is the object, the Q object pointer. The second parameter is the function name, the method name. And the third parameter is the way you want to invoke the method. Qt connection, it means it posts some kind of runnable on Qt loop, and then it exits immediately. Blocking Qt connection means this function waits until this the other function it's called, it's finished. Otherwise, it will block forever. Why we need it to wait when the SD card is unmounted? Well, if you remove the SD card and you have some open files on the SD card, if you don't close all the files when you get this notification, the kernel, the Android kernel, will kill your application. So again, this is quite useful example for you if you are using the SD card. Here, it's the same thing that we do to register the function. We have two functions here. We specify the function signature, the function pointer, and we are using JNIi onload to register them. And this is the diagram for C++ part. So we call from Qt thread a Java function. The Android gets a notification about SD card mounted or unmounted, and it calls a C++ static function. The C++ static function use Q meta object invoke method to post, to delegate the call of onReceiveMounted function in Qt thread. This is the full diagram. So first step, C++ goes in Java. Java posts a runnable on Android thread. Android event loop picks up this runnable and it executes it here. These are the third steps you need to do a safe call from C++ to Java. The other way around, where something happened in Android thread, we call a native method from Java to C++. In C++, instead to call to access the objects from this foreign thread, we delegate the call into Qt thread And here, it's safe for us to append the text. If you append here the text, your application might crash. Okay, and that's it.
Questions?
Yes.
One question, what happens if the application and the application goes in the background? What happens in the two specs?
What happened
with the two specs? I noticed that with Q5 they are not running anymore.
Yes. When your application goes in background, the Q event loop is freezed. Also, the Android event loop is freezed. They're blocked. And when your application goes back in front, they're resuming the execution. And if your call, let's say you post a runnable here, and your application goes in background, when the application goes back in foreground, it will continue the execution. There is a way to allow the the main Qt event loop to not to block, but you need to change a single line in your Android manifest file. But I really, really do not recommend you to do that, because if you try to draw something when your application is in background, the OpenGL surface is not valid anymore, and your application might crash. So if you have a QML application that does some animations and it goes in background and you don't freeze these animations, your application will crash. That's why we block everything, we freeze everything to be sure your application will not draw anything as it is in background. It's not like iOS. On iOS, the operating system does that for you. On Qt, we do that for you.
Okay, this question was about sockets, so that means...
Everything is freezed. Timer, sockets, everything. Because the sockets and the timer are processed by the main event loop. And if that is freeze, everything freeze. But you can also do something smarter. You can create your another event loop, and that event loop will process your sockets and on another thread, and you can use that to process sockets and timers.
Only the main
Qt thread. Okay. Other questions? No, you can set this on your control. If you are using QML, there is some input method hints. Sorry?
Widgets.
It has some input hints, and it will display only the numeric. If you set only numeric, it will display only the numeric values.
This is also standard Qt available?
It's standard Qt, yes. Yes? Qt UI?
Yes.
Of course, it lives on the Qt thread.
Can you overlay stuff on the...
Doing synchronization. We do a lot of synchronization between these threads. Actually, on Android application, it only needs a context. And we create the context in Qt thread, and we do all the OpenGL calls in Qt thread. It's easy. But if you want to add on top of your application, let's say, a native Android control, a native Java control, then you need to do some synchronization. For instance, when you move your screen, your page up and down, you also need to move the Java control. But that's on Android thread, not on Qt thread.
More questions? Yes?
I'm more interested in the JNIi part, and I would like to mention the two threads, well, the thread basically in a separate Java thread?
No, it's a native thread, it's a P thread.
So,
when the Java part loads everything, as I said, it can't call your main function from Android thread. And we create another thread from C++ using pthreads. And inside that thread, we call your main function.
Okay, so basically, don't use a different Java thread.
No. The Android Java part creates its own threads, but that's managed by the Java. We don't care about them. And also Qt creates some threads. For instance, if you are using QML, the rendering is done in another thread, not in the Qt main thread.
So basically manage all the QL stuff in a different Qt thread.
Yeah.
Any other question? We have plenty of time, so please don't be shy.
You can ask questions about Qt on Android, not only about this session. If you have other questions, I'm okay. Yes? Okay.
Is it a mix of worlds? Like I write one activity in Qt and the others in any?
Yes,
it's
possible, but can't overlay the displays. So you can't create a single activity in Java with some controls and with for half of screen, and the other half of screen it's QML. No, you can't do that. So, but what you can use the Qt as a service or some backend and do everything in Java if you like, or you can mix them anywhere you like. Yes. Starting with Qt 5.4, we try to use as many native stuff that we found on Android. Sadly, on Android, you don't have dialogs for file selection or font selection and so on, and we need to create those dialogs by ourselves. Yes? Yes? Yes.
Every Java framework like Spring.
Yes. Well, now if I don't know if Spring works on Android, but if it works, then you can use it also on a Qt application. So every single piece of code that runs on Android, you can access from a Qt application.
No more questions? Okay, let's thank Bogdan.
Thank you.